Hello and welcome in this session on active learning. When we talk about active learning, it doesn't mean that if a learner is active in your classroom, active learning is taking place in your classroom. Active learning is basically a concept which has its roots in constructivist pedagogy. I am Dr. Gaurav Singh, your course instructor for the course Learning and Teaching. And in today's discussion on active learning, we will discuss its various dimensions, how you can use it effectively in your classroom, and what are the strategies which you can adopt for using active learning in your class. But before going to its definitions, its methods, its strategies, let us talk about certain situations which you may come across in your classroom. Do you think that every learning situation where a student is active is active learning? Let us see few situations. There is a scenario in which a class there are students and they are consciously listening to a lecture. Then there is another scenario where a teacher is explaining to the students and the student is taking notes of it. Then the another situation is that in a language classroom, a teacher asks to the students to read certain paragraphs from a language textbook, and the students are reading that paragraph as per the instructions of the teacher. Or in a classroom, a teacher has taught something, the student has memorized that, and now teacher is asking them to respond to the questions asked by the teacher based on their own memory. Do you think that if a student is actively listening a lecture, or a teacher is explaining and students are taking notes, or students are reading a paragraph from a language textbook, or they are responding to the questions asked by the teacher based on their memory, is it active learning? No, it is not. Then the question is, what is active learning? Actually, when we talk about active learning, we need to consider certain definitions. And the best idea about active learning was given in 1991 in an article, Active Learning, Creating Excitement in the Classroom, and that was written by Vanwell and Eason. Vanwell and Eason said that active learning is anything that involves students in doing things and thinking about the things which they are doing. So active learning doesn't mean only the active involvement of the learners in doing things, but also if they are thinking and reflecting what they are doing, then it is active. In another definition given by NSSE and AUSSE, which was reported by Carr et al. In 2015, it was said that active learning involves students' efforts to actively construct their knowledge. So a student not only learn, rather they construct their knowledge. And from where this idea of construction of knowledge has came? It has came from constructivist pedagogy. So what is active learning? Again, I am going to quote Vanwell and Eason. And Vanwell and Eason in the same article have said that students must do more than just listen. They must read, write, discuss, or be engaged in solving problems. The most important is to be actively involved. Students must engage in such higher order thinking tasks like analysis, synthesis, and evaluation. So active learning is not only recalling and recognizing, rather it focuses on analysis, synthesis, and evaluation. You recall the objectives suggested by B.S. Bloom in the cognitive domain of Bloom's taxonomy. Analysis, synthesis, and evaluation comes at higher order. But the question is, from where this idea has emerged? What is the theoretical foundation of this? If you analyze the different ideas of active learning, you will find that the roots of active learning are in constructivism. And if you follow the idea of social constructivism by Vygotsky, you will see what Vygotsky has said, that learners construct their knowledge with social interaction, with talking to each other, with sharing to each other. Same is the idea of active learning. Active learning focuses more on higher order thinking. And where are the roots? Roots are in the Bloom's taxonomy. Because active learning focuses on analysis, synthesis, and evaluation, which are higher order objectives of Bloom taxonomy. Let us think now that what is the importance of active learning? Actually, active learning nurtures the brain of the learner. It gives an opportunity to connect the new information with the old information, and it corrects the previous misconceptions if there are any with the learners, because learners construct their meaning, they analyze the situation, they share their perception and reflections with each other, so they basically overcome the misconceptions if they have in their mind, and they reconsider existing thoughts and opinions, they challenge them, they actively construct a new meaning. So when we talk about importance of active learning, we should be very clear that active learning is a cognitive activity where learners are active not only physically but cognitively. So it is said that in active learning, students learn more when they are participating in the process of learning. So they not only learn the content which is being taught to them and which is being presented to them. So learning is not as a product here, rather learning is here as a process. Active learning basically encourages the brain of the students to activate cognitive and sensory network, which helps in processing and storing the new information. So we can say that more we will activate to our students' brain in different ways, more they learn. So what is our role? We should present the same kind of information in different formats, in different ways, or we can present the situation and we should encourage our students to analyze that situation, to analyze that scenario from different perspectives. When they will analyze the same thing from different perspectives, their brains will become active and their sensory networks will become active and they will learn how to learn. So active learning basically focuses on the process of learning, that a student learns how to learn. Engaging in as many as sensory, cognitive, emotional and social processes to the students, it will definitely increase their learning potential. When we talk about active learning, many times it has been asked that how it is different from passive learning, or what is the difference between passive learning and active learning. So let us try to analyze both the situation. In passive learning, it is always one-way transfer of information. Whereas in active learning, learners and teachers are involved with each other, they co-construct their knowledge. In passive learning, it is the lecture which is being delivered by the teacher on an important issue matters more. But in active learning, it is not the lecture, but the discussion on the lecture where learners share their experiences, their ideas about the lecture which is being delivered by the teacher are more important. Similarly, if a teacher is simply showing a video or an image without any interaction, without any question, without any involvement of the learners in analyzing that image or that video, that is passive learning. But if you use image or video to initiate the discussion, to start the reflection, to ignite the minds of your learners, then it is active learning. It is the teacher who controls the instruction in passive learning environment, and he or she decides the pace of learning. But in active learning, these are the learners who decide the pace of learning because they cooperate in the instructional process. On one side, passive learning basically promotes the memorization, recall and recognition, but active learning promotes higher order thinking, reflection, analysis, evaluation and creation. But there are certain misconceptions also about the active learning. Before moving towards the strategies, let us talk about certain misconceptions. The first misconception is that active learning is all about doing a particular activity. No, it is not. If a learner is doing something and that thing which he or she is doing mechanically, just following the orders, it may be a misconception or it may be a perception of yours that the learner is doing something, but is he or she applying his or her mind also, or it is merely the he or she is following the orders or the instructions? Sometimes it is again a misconception that active learning is same as inquiry based learning. No, it is not. Active learning always does not involve the question or the problem, but mostly in inquiry based learning, it is the problem or the question whole inquiry is woven around which. Next misconception is that active learning means taking away the teacher's influence. No, it is not. Many teachers often say that if we involve the active learning process, our role will become lesser or we don't have much importance. The students will not be in our influence. Who is talking about influence? Let us create an environment where we with our students construct the knowledge. So there is no question of teacher's influence. Then some people are saying that active learning means a complete change in teaching style and classroom layout. Again, this is a misconception. Active learning never asks for you to change your whole teaching style or classroom layout. Even you can use small strategies in your traditional teaching learning and you can do it in the same setup of your classroom, in the same layout of your classroom in which you are regularly teaching. Another misconception is that active learning will cause bad behavior. This is again a misconception. Why? Because if we ask our students to involve in the activities where they are more active, they share with each other, they learn how to work in team, they learn how to understand others' ideas, this basically brings certain social skills among them. So it will never cause a bad behavior. The another misconception is that students have to be physically active. No. Active learning doesn't mean only physical activity. Active learning means their brains are active. They are continuously reflecting, analyzing, synthesizing, creating. Only then they are doing something like active learning. One more misconception is that active learning makes a student less respectful. Again, this is a misconception. Active learning makes a student more responsible. They learn social skills. They learn life skills. So it is not that active learning makes a student less respectful. Rather, it makes them more ready to face the challenges of their life. So what we can do as a teacher to develop an active learning environment in our classroom? We should remember that learners are not only the transporters of knowledge. They are not here to get something from you and report to someone else, or get something from you and report in the term and examination or in the test. No. So learners are not transporters of knowledge. They are knowledge creators. They are knowledge explorers. So what you should do? You should give them more opportunity and more importance for the construction of knowledge by their own. When you are creating an active learning environment in your class, it is the leadership and the initiative which should be presented to the learners, and learners should learn how to lead. The leadership and initiation qualities should be developed among the learner. Let us move towards certain techniques which you can use in your classroom to use active learning. The very common technique is pause. Pause is the most common technique. Why? Because it enhances the understanding and retention. So what you can do? Simply, if you are taking a class of 30 minutes, plan a pause after 10 or 12 minutes, two or three pauses. And while you are taking pauses, you ask your students to reflect what they have learned in past 10 or 12 minutes. So this will make them active. Then you can design certain informal tests and quizzes, which you can give to your students during your classroom. It will help them in keeping active during the lecture. So this is again a very important technique. Then you can use sometimes demonstration, especially in the science classrooms or in the laboratory activities. Every time you should not present any experiment or you should not do all demonstrations. Involve your students. They should be equal partner in the experiments and demonstrations. If they know something, let them demonstrate. Give them opportunity to demonstrate their skills. And you also demonstrate with the help of your students. In this way, you can involve them actively. Next is the retrieval practice. It is also a very common technique. The students may be asked to write something in 2 minutes or 3 minutes, what you have taught to them in last class or the preceding class. So they will recall it, they will reflect on it, and they will write it. Another very common practice is think, pair, share. This is again a collaborative technique which we can use even in our active classroom. So what we can do? Let us share certain issues or some points to our students. Let a student think and write about an issue, discuss in the pairs and with the peer, then develop understanding in between two, and then both of them may be asked to share with the group, and group will reflect back on their ideas or on their thinking. So this is again a very effective technique. Then minute paper is a very common technique. In this technique, the students reflect or do critical thinking of an issue or question and write for 1 minute, and then they share their responses to stimulate the discussion. So what you can do while you are teaching, you can pause or you can take a break after 10 minutes. Then you put a question or an issue in front of your students. Let your student reflect on it for next 2 minutes, and then you give them 1 minute opportunity. Okay, like what you have reflected in last 2 minutes, what you have analyzed, you write in next 1 minute. So such kind of activities you can use. So there is no dearth of activities or there is no dearth of strategies in active learning. If you see this continuum, this is a spectrum of active learning activities which was basically developed by Chris O'Neill and Tertia Painter Grove, and they put it from simple to complex. So the activities like minute paper, pause the reflection, self-assessment, think pairs here, they are the simpler activities. But the activities like structural learning, forum theater, inquiry learning, jigsaw technique, role playing, these are the complex activities or complex strategies. So you can decide any strategy which are being suggested here. There are certain tools which you can use to help in active learning. One such tool is concept map. You must be using concept map while planning for your teaching learning, either in lesson planning or in unit planning. But here it is a very effective use of concept map. If you ask your students to create a concept map, let them identify the key concepts which you are going to discuss or which you have discussed. Let them identify the related concepts. Let them find out what is the relationship between concepts and subconcepts. So you can do this activity in small groups, or you can give this activity to whole class. If you don't have much time for concept mapping, the another activity is mini maps. So what you can do here, in the concept map activities, students were asked to identify the concept and subconcept. Here you can give them a list of concepts and subconcepts. Let them arrange these concepts and subconcepts in some logical structure, some meaningful relationship with arrows and words. So this technique again you can use. A strip sequence is also a very effective technique. Where you can use this technique? You can use this technique when you are talking about some process or steps of a process. So you can write these steps of a process in different strips. You give them all those strips jumbled, let them discuss within the group and arrange all the strips in a sequence, and they can reconstruct the whole sequence of the process. Another very effective technique is student-generated test questions. Many times, we prepare our question papers. When we decide about any lesson or any unit, we decide the unit objectives or lesson objectives or learning outcomes. And to test that whether those learning outcomes have been achieved or not, you prepare certain test items. Let us do it as an activity for active learning. What you need to do? You provide the action verbs and the learning objectives to your students, which you have decided. And you ask your students to prepare the question through which they want that their learning outcomes should be tested. So in place of you, let students generate certain questions. So when they will generate questions, they will reflect that why this question is required. What is the relationship of this question with the objective? In teacher training programs, you can use it very effectively. Even in higher classes, you can use it. Then case-based learning. It is a very popular technique, especially one of the complex techniques of active learning, where you provide a case to the students and you ask them to decide what they know, that what is the relevance of this case, what information they need to collect, from where they want to collect the information, what will be the impact of their analysis, or what are the implications of their decision which they are going to take in the case. So such kind of tools you can use to make your classroom an effective active learning classroom. So what you can do as a teacher? First thing is that you facilitate your learners for independent, critical and creative thinking. If you are not giving them opportunity for independent thinking, for critical reflection, for creative thinking, it will be difficult for you to manage an active classroom. You encourage effective collaboration. The collaboration which is for some purpose, So you give them certain collaborative activities where they collaborate with each other. They not only give you the solution of the problem, but they also learn how to work in group in collaboration. You increase their time investment, their motivation, and their performance. Sopkins, as cited by Roser in 1983, wrote somewhere, and I quote, "One must learn by doing the things, for though you think you can know it, you have no certainty until you try it." So, dear teachers, I must say that effective learning is a very important teaching learning strategy or technique which you can use in your classroom. In active learning, you will ask your learners, you will provide the opportunity to your learners to co-construct the knowledge, to construct their own knowledge. Let them create their own world. Let us encourage them for active learning and make our classroom an active classroom. Thank you very much.